Love is but a song we sing. Fears we will die.
The war against poverty will not be won here in Washington. It must be won in the field, in every private home, in every public office, from the courthouse to the White House. Lyndon B. Johnson, State of the Union Address, 1964.
A major part of President Johnson's national agenda, the war on poverty greatly affected millions of people all over the country, and notably in the secluded mountains of Appalachia. President Johnson's efforts to eradicate poverty created thousands of public service jobs through which young Americans served in impoverished communities. Thousands of young college students were sent into the rural hills of North Carolina, Tennessee, Kentucky, and West Virginia through programs like Volunteers and Service to America, also known as VISTA, and Appalachian Volunteers. In the 1960s, 1970s, and 1980s, young Americans made a lasting impact on the educational and personal lives of mountain people and people throughout the world.
In an address in 1965, Robert F. Kennedy said, "Our present generation of young people in the Peace Corps, in the Foreign Students Movement, in Appalachia, in Oakland, in the dusty eddies of Mississippi, on the narrow trails of the Andes, have shown an idealism, a devotion to country matched in few nations and excelled in none. And they've affected all our lives as well, in many ways, large and small."
Many of the outside volunteers in Appalachia came from the Volunteers and Service to America program. Most of the VISTAs were involved in educational assistance. For example, they were teachers at Sandy Mush School, a low-income school near Asheville. The teaching volunteers at Sandy Mush provided daily progress reports that gave insight into their experience. VISTAs were also involved in creating an occupational training school for adults, which was ran through Western Carolina University and provided and improved basic adult education. VISTAs also assisted the organization WAMI with many projects in Watauga, Avery, Mitchell, and Yancey counties. Wilsona Burke, a VISTA volunteer assigned to WAMI during the 60s, stated,
"We were assigned to two different places. We went to the Avery County Social Services and the Avery County School Board, and they had us things already in line that they wanted us to work with. They sent us out to different schools to tutor children that were in summer school and to go there with them. In fact, at one time, we went to a school where they had an adult education program in the summertime. These people were working for the county, but they couldn't read or write, and they wanted us to help them to teach them how to read or write. That was most unusual to me, to work with an adult who couldn't read or write. Working with the kids was not a problem, because we'd go to Kmart and buy these little books with the alphabet, or with the vowel sounds and the consonants and all this stuff, and work with them like that. They talked differently than we did, and teaching them not to talk that way was not a good idea."
Another group that many of the volunteers came from was the Appalachian Volunteers, or AVs. They were unionized and much more radical than the VISTAs. In fact, many people thought they were communists. They helped organize labor groups and unions, and groups against strip mining. They also worked on centralizing the water systems of Appalachia, much to the dismay of many natives. Some less controversial projects involved putting together a group of distinguished doctors to help diagnose diseases in the natives.
The role of the VISTA volunteers in the community is limited to the image they present to the community, and by the image the community wished the VISTA would present.
As the quote alludes to, the presence of the outside volunteers in the community occasioned many different views. When the Appalachian Volunteers worked in eastern Kentucky to try to centralize the water systems, people were either angry or appreciative. For example, James Hamilton referred to the AVs as the nicest bunch of young people we've ever had in this community. In addition, a 27-year-old Appalachian woman reported how positive an impact the VISTA's volunteers had had on her life.
She discussed how they helped her and her communities set up schools and run businesses and provide better food. She said they were helping her achieve her dream of being a teacher one day and helping her fall back in love.
While many community reactions to volunteers were positive, just as many, if not more, were negative. In the fall of 1968, the actions of the Appalachian Volunteers and VISTA workers in eastern Kentucky were called into question at a hearing held by the Kentucky Un-American Activities Committee. A grand jury in Pikeville, Kentucky, indicted the anti-poverty groups for plotting to overthrow the government and possessing communist beliefs.
The director of the Appalachian Volunteers, David Walls, responded, "Those who called for QAC investigation did so in order to harass poor people's groups whose interests they oppose." Walls claimed that rich conservatives who owned coal mines were against the AVs and VISTAs because they feared that the volunteers would end the exploitation of the poor through labor organizing and education.
While QAC was eventually disbanded along with other committees of its type around the United States, their investigation exposed a large number of local Appalachians who held negative opinions about the VISTAs and AVs. One paper claimed that the AVs and VISTAs have been under fire for everything from dressing like hippies to organizing groups opposed to strip mining. The hearing brought forth testimonials from mountain people who claimed that the volunteers made fun of poor people and wrecked mountain people's ability to do things for themselves.
Additionally, natives questioned the virtue of the bright young do-gooder from up north, who would boss around teachers and corrupt students. QAC's final recommendation on the AVs and VISTAs before its disbandment was that volunteers should be native to where they work.
Not all disapproval of the volunteers was verbal. In addition, volunteers even faced threats of violence, such as a bomb threat described in the Willis v. Weatherford papers.
Volunteers felt the negative sentiments of those they served. Wilsona Burke recounted her experience as a white college student from outside as
naive. "I'm going to help you. I'm going to fix things for you. I'm going to make things better for you." And they were so gracious, and it was like, "Aw, here comes some people that's going to help us again. I'm just thankful they didn't kill us, because we were so over the top with all that we wanted to do and how we thought we were going to take care of things. I just don't think we didn't have all the skills we needed. We were young enough to be flexible, but we weren't smart enough to be as gracious to them as they had been to us. But I learned differently later." So they had a, like I say, I learned a lot more from them than I taught them. They were very helpful to me in my life.
Many volunteers had similar experience to Wilsona Burke. While many recount their positive experiences with the people of the mountains, they still experienced frustration. Eddie Weinman, a VISTA teacher in the mountains of North Carolina, wrote in her daily reports that she was annoyed by the slow nature of life in Appalachia and was slightly disgusted by the extreme poverty and cultural deprivation of the children she worked with. Other volunteers were also surprised by the poverty of the area, but many cited their experience there as eye-opening and life-changing in a positive way.
A brochure to recruit volunteers for the AVs included several testimonials from past volunteers who claimed, "The area has become a part of me, and I came as a stranger. I left with an invitation and desire to return. We've all learned a lot from each other." Even though mountain people voiced their concerns about the volunteers, the overwhelming majority of volunteers claimed that they learned more from the people of that region than they themselves could have ever taught them. Remembering her experience as a VISTA, Mrs. Burke said, "I forgot what the question was. What was I doing for them? I'm not sure that I did as much for them as they did for me."
Finally, Mrs. Burke's interviewer asked her if she thought the community treated her differently because of her status as a VISTA volunteer. She responded, "I think they did. It was close. The communities in the mountains are so close-knit that if anyone knew anything in a community, they could tell everybody. Everybody would know about it. So I don't think that we went anywhere that we weren't identified to as who we were. And we were treated as such. We were treated as though..." Irony was, we thought we went there to help people in poverty. They didn't know they were in poverty. They didn't think they were in poverty. They didn't know what poverty was because they were getting along just fine.
Although they were outsiders to Appalachia, VISTA and AV volunteers made meaningful contributions to the lives of mountain people, and their legacy can be seen in several facets of Appalachian life today. Thoughts are broken. Perhaps they're better left unsung. I don't know. Don't really care. Let there be some.